of things about this team, and it really is such a diverse team from such a challenging area of New York State. The High Needs High School, which is Newburgh Free Academy, which means that they are underfunded, but this is therefore such an important project for everyone to get involved with. A real strong female representation in the team as well. None other than Elena King, 17-year-old from Newburgh in New York State. We'll let Elena get off on her lap. Let's cross to Io in the paddock.
Wonderful. So I'm here with Shannon, who looks after the Americans. Hello. Hi guys, we've got some here. Shannon, tell us a little bit more about these cars, please. We've got one here, we've got one. We're definitely missing another one, but tell us a little bit more about this one behind us.
Yes, we have three teams from the United States of America participating and competing in the Driver World Championship today. So this car is an electric car from Minnesota. We actually have another team from Minnesota as well, which is a diesel car. And there's one car on the track now, which is from New York, and they're also electric.
Okay, now tell me, how do you think your guys are going to fare against Asia, against London, against the UK, or how do you think you guys are going to do?
Oh, the Americans are going to do excellent by far. I definitely think we're going to be one of the top three, if not maybe all three,
who knows? Oh my goodness, this is a lot of fighting talk here, you know? I'm feeling it. I see what you're saying, but all the best of luck to you. But also, I just hope these cars get on the track safely as well, because it's about safety, isn't it?
Yes, safety is most important.
Good luck.
So much indeed. Shanna, thank you, Io. And in fact, last year the top three was split between the three continents. Shanna sounded confident about the America's team's chances. Well, they ended up third in the DWC Grand Final with Knights 3 last time around, second with Lycée Toulon of France, and first was Bumi Sulawangi, who were the winners from Indonesia. Now, the DWC is so difficult, it's such a brutal competition this time around. The Bumi Sulawangi, last year's winners, didn't even qualify. They are unable to defend their crown. So that means that they have to be represented instead by two other teams from Indonesia. That's Bengawan Team 2, who are in a diesel-powered car, and the ITS Team 2 are also in a diesel-powered car. We'll see how they fare as they represent Asia. And as Shannon Riley said, Newburgh Goldbacks are out on track right now, and you've also got St. Thomas Academy Experimental Vehicle Team. They had to do a second brake test. And also, not just those two, but you've got the Knights 3 team, who were in that kind of car that had a sort of see-through look, and the Logan Sailor with the driver in that car. Right, let's have a little look now at Elena's lap as she goes round for qualifying. We're now into deciding the grid order. So it's all about timings here. It's all about typical qualifying, where the fastest team after qualifying ends up at the front of the grid, the second fastest team, second spot on the grid. And that will then decide the grid order for the race at 4:30 p.m, which will be streaming live on Facebook and on YouTube. So this is Elena, this is her one lap. She's coming up to the top of the hill. Now, she was telling me a bit earlier on, she's very confident, very laid back about how she's going to approach this. But it's a question of how much they value qualifying. Just moves over the manhole cover at the top of the brow of the hill, and there's the extra result behind her. Here is Elena then, now coming up the power. Or is she actually going to burn the rest? Is she going to try and get a quick time in here? And look at her energy stores, down to 19.3, 18.8, and behind them, yes, are all out of energy, in fact, just down to 1.6. And here it is, Elena from the Newburgh Goldbacks team, in her car, which is known as the Hack, around paddock corner, around the final paddock chicane, and getting towards the line. And it looks like she is pretty much out of energy. Well, very, very soon, we will find out exactly what her time is in any case. And Nyetsa as well are through. And Nyetsa is the team from Bergen, you can tell them because, well, basically, their car would stand out in the dark, wouldn't it? That's that blue flower power car. Everything to do with it is to do with Burgundy. So the livery with the grapes on it and the fleur-de-lis and even a little snail on the top of the antenna, that is the Nyetsa car. So they have come through as well. So those are the first two that have gone through. Newburgh Goldbacks electric powered car and Nyetsa Carbon Zero electric powered car. Let's go back to the paddock and back.
Thanks, David. Yeah, right. Oh, we're walking. Okay, the cars are now heading out to the practice. This is Luke, this is your car right behind. We're kind of walking and talking at the same time. How are you feeling? How's it going?
Oh, it's going pretty good. We just did a second brake test because Logan missed the first stop and they were going to do it again.
Okay, that's what it's all about. Recovery here, failed the first time, get back out there. Luke, go see your car. Good luck. David, back to you.
See, that's what it's all about, isn't it, Becky? It's all about whether you can recover from the challenges that are set to you. And the brake test is an absolutely imperative part of this. as IO rightly said earlier on, it is all about safety. We want these cars to race, we want them to race well, we want them to race competitively, but above all, we want them to race safely. And they've been giving briefings, the drivers, both last night for the European qualifiers for the regionals, and then everyone today, for exactly how they should race. That includes rules of corners, racing lines, changing lines, which is not permitted, etc, etc. But clearly, in order to get through to qualifying and then the race, you've got to go through the brake test. And as we heard there from the Knights 3 team, Logan missed the first time around, managed to rescue the second time around, and he goes through to qualifying. And we will try and bring you an update on whether we do have all nine cars for this qualifying session. But there you can get a sense of the atmosphere of this building around the track. You can see the grandstands are packed, members of the public, the teams themselves, some VIPs, some special guests. If you were here yesterday, you'll know that we had Alicia Dixon of Strictly and the older ones amongst us, Mystique, fame. That is the sort of entertainment that we have had on view at the Make the Future Live here at the Queen Elizabeth Park. Right, let's head back to Aya. Where are you?
I'm back here with Sam and Peter from Centaurus Academy in Minnesota. And these are the winners from the Americans. So you guys must be confident going into this,
no? Yeah, we're running pretty good last time, so it's pretty good speed, so we're feeling pretty good ourselves.
Just tell me about the car a little bit here, in terms of design, in terms of what its capabilities are.
So we're a battery electric car, and we can go about 51 kilometers an hour, so it's just going to be
Thanks very much indeed, Io. So yes, interesting to see how St. Thomas Academy's experimented vehicle team will go this time around. We're about to see La Jolie Polytechnology absolutely smashed it in qualifying earlier on when they won their regional final. They won with an incredible lap time, and also that very same St. Thomas Academy experimental vehicle team. They use computer-aided design, or CAD, to design their car. It's got much, much better aerodynamics, and in fact, last year, when they competed in the Drivers World Championship, not in the final, but in one of the previous processes before then, with another battery electric car, they rolled in the hairpin. It was a moment of concern, but thankfully the driver was unhurt. But what was important about that is they took the learnings from it, and they've gone for the win. They've said that actually the priority for them this year is the Drivers' World Championship. They've got to do well at the Shellico Marathon and be efficient anyway to get through, but bearing in mind that they'd already kind of logged that and they knew they could rely on their history of the competition to get through that, they had strong performance in the last 5 years and barely been outside the top three. Well, they then focus on the Drivers' World Championship. So this is designed for this particular event. Not just the mileage challenge, but that mixture between speed and efficiency and the race to find the fastest energy efficient driver. We've got a little cloud cover here as well, and that might just be a little bit of comfort to the drivers in their race overalls. It's going to be hot in those cockpits as we just look across the park. Thankfully, I don't think there are any too dark clouds out there, because that's what we want to avoid. We had heard earlier in the weekend that there might be thunderstorms heading our way, but as we just glance across the skies, that looks hopefully fairly safe to me. Let's just hope that that's moving away rather than towards the circuit. And you can see there's plenty of other activities there. Our energy future on the move, liberal at play. Go and have a little look, but remember that we are building up to the real action on track. 4:30 is when our race starts, and our coverage starts live on Facebook and on YouTube at 4 p.m. I'll be joined by Jason Bradbury from The Gadget Show, and of course, Ohio. And thank you all for being here today. This is Mr. McPike, who's in group walk, Martin Brundle Stiley. I'll be talking to Nick Collins, who is the head of vehicle reliability at Ferrari. He's also involved in the Ferrari Academy, and not only that, he's a real backer, a real sort of a supporter of the Drivers' World Championship. On we go again now. Team 902. This is the Bengawan Team 2 from Indonesia. The Wears were from Indonesia last year, as I was telling us, and these guys have got to represent and see if they can get through to a decent grid position. Off they go, over the bridge, on the Benjamin, and they're heading towards the swimming pool complex. This is just gently downhill. They'll be picking up a little bit of speed, but there's no need to burn too much. They've got to think about that hill, and they've got to think about the hairpin a bit later on, the complex series of curves. This is the swimming pool, very much like Monaco, the Monaco Grand Prix double section. It's essentially two gentle left-handers, and then after that, we've got the second part of it. Now remember, this is all about grid order. In any other qualifying series that you may well have heard of, it's about the fastest times and it's about trying to get the good grid position. Second part of the swimming pool complex, and then we're going to go through to Aquatics Curve. We're going to take this through all the way through to the hairpin with the Ben Gawan team too. Rifki Dwee for Tranto, the 22-year-old from Surakarta. Let's just have a look to see how he negotiates Aquatics Curve. A little slow actually on the entry here, but how will he do as he comes into the hairpin? He's about to come into shot now. There he is. Well, he's gone probably the middle way through that. It's reasonable. And let's just see what kind of purchase he gets on the Westfield bend. That's okay, but will it be enough to crucially clinch an important and a useful and advantageous grid slot? Let's head to Becky.
Thanks, David. Yes, I'm trackside now with Adrian. Now, there are so many other people that work so hard to get to the point you're at now. Adrian, it's one of them. You've been our technical team this weekend. How are you feeling? What's been your role within this?
Well, I assist
and are you enjoying it? Is it all going to plan so far?
It's all going great.
You heard it here first. It's all going great. David, back to you.
To hear. Thank you very much indeed, Becky. Keep up coming with your updates. Absolutely fantastic stuff. Just giving you the real inside line of what's going on inside the paddocks, and I can tell you that the atmosphere will be building there as well. As we continue with Bang Wen Team 2 from Indonesia, an aluminium chassis, a carbon fibre body. They say it's got good aerodynamics, a powerful machine with a light frame. And they had a little steering issue in previous running here, but they managed to sort that out. Just to tell you how we're doing so far. Certainly right now, Nyitsa have a good advantage. They're the team from France, and they're the ones with the crazy livery of Burgundy. They are fastest so far, 2 minutes 29. Solar Car Solutions, Essent Toulon, one of the other French teams, 3 minutes 1.445 seconds. And Hugo Goldbach's currently third of the cars that have gone out for qualifying, 3 minutes 16. And we will see exactly where Ben Gawan team 2 end up, through the paddock corner, through the paddock chicane, and over the line. How has Rifki done? And in fact, in terms of their race strategy, do you know what? A nice sort of middle position might suit them. They are likely to hang back in the middle of the pack and then really push on lap 3 and lap 4. Yeah. And so as soon as we get a time for Ben Gawan Team 2, we will let you know where exactly they sit. We've got 4 teams that have done, and we've got 4 more teams to go. And so we confirm to you the news that Team 903, DLSU car team from Philippines, were disqualified. They did not make through their brake tests. They were eliminated in practice, and so as a result, they are not able to take part in qualifying. We've got 2 more cars lining up to go out for qualifying. As you can see, the front one there, Jean-Yves Lee, Polytechnot, and also behind them, Team 906, which is Knight 3, and we heard from them with the Becky once again. Let's head back to the paddock and back to Ion.
Nice one, David. As you can see, there's a lovely screen here that all the teams are watching and see where they've been placed in the race. So this is basically to see where everyone's going to determine grid order, and also you can see the battery life as well. So, I mean, it's all happening. It's all rounding up to the big grand final, and John is back here for one season.
Thanks, Ion. Do you know what? He's so humble. He didn't mention the fact that you can see him on that screen. And obviously that's the star attraction. Come on. But here we go, with the 2 more cars in qualifying. So we've got 4 that have already registered their qualifying time. Nyitsa of France, from Ben Gawan Team 2, Solar Car Solutions of France, and Hugo Goldbach. And off to a massive round of applause for those non-league teams, Polytechnos and San Sebastian. So wow, this is City Crew. This is one of the real stalwart teams of the Shirley Co Marathon. They participated in that particular competition back from the 1980s, and their previous cars, Micro Joule and also Pony Joule, they have 11 world records between them. This is the latest member of the family, it's City Joule, and this cheeky little customer has completed his 5th SEM, and at the final of the last Drunk World Championship, where they were involved. So off they go, they're into the bitumen section, over the bridge, and through to the swimming pool concept once more. It's a good tight line there, and they've managed to judge that very, very well through the first part of the swimming pool complex. Remember, no need to do a brake test now. That's all been done. It's all about timings, it's all about qualifying. So they're going to take a little wide line through, see if they can take a slightly tighter grip through that apex. That's well done. Do you know what? I think this team are going to do very, very well indeed. In fact, let's get a reaction from the team with Becky.
Right, Anton, with the Indonesian team coming here. Now, you were very confident before heading out for qualifying. How's it gone for you?
It's really interesting.
Second position on the grid. How are you feeling about that? You happy? Do you wish it was first?
We're going to stop here.
Optimistic.
Optimistic.
Optimistic. optimistic. That is a very good word to describe what's happening right down here at the paddock. It's a great sense of optimism. Right, take it back to you.
Thank you, Becky. Well, Penguin Team 2 right now, a second, but remember, we still have a car out on track who lies on the lead, Polytechnons, who look like they've done very, very well. They're coming up right now through to the loop. Let's just catch up with them. Here they are, that bright blue livery, and they're completely carved around 100 kilograms, and it's Adeline Coudon. And Coudon in French means careful, but you know what? She is going for it here. She's hammering it up the hill. Have a look at this for speed, and in terms of her battery power, well, the hydrogen fuel cell has still got 69, 68. Now, how much has she got left? This is the question. She's up at the brow of the hill, and down she comes. She's well in with this here. I think that this might well be a competition, guys, as we head down towards the corner. She's looking incredibly calm, and that's the time for 601. Lands on his knee, Polytechnons. I reckon that's gone popped it as it has. Look at that time. 2 minutes, 15 seconds. That is the best time by 15 seconds. It will take a lot to beat that. And remember, this is the only hydrogen fuel cell car on the grid. It's in the minority by some margin. And the other cars, the internal combustion engine cars and the diesel cars, and also the battery electric cars, they have got four each in terms of representation. But little Micro Joule and little City Joule, it's latest iteration is doing very, very well. Now we're back on board with some of them. They've gone through another lap, in fact, have Lajonie P. But the latest car on track there is going to be setting a time now is Knight 3. So let's see if we can try and find Knight 3. They've just started their lap. And in fact, if I can just have a look through my monitors and see if we can find, they're just down by, let's have a look, the back half of the grid. So they're just about to approach the loop. So in fact, here we go. This
loop,
is the steep incline circuit. Well,
what
this is the pre-incline, really. This is where
we
just start to get a feel for what's coming.
This
we're about to see Knight 3 from
my
old Columbia High School in Minnesota. But look, here's a little concern here. And for Logan, who is in the cockpit, he's only got 35% of his energy remaining. And they've still got the hill to negotiate. He's got to hope the aerodynamics of his car and the natural momentum of his car are going to help him get through. Let's just stick with the hill climb for the moment before we cross back to the paddock and see how much more energy. He's down to 14%, down to 8%. He's got to make sure he gets to the brow of the hill before he reaches zero. I think he's got enough momentum, and he's over the top, and he's down towards the paddock corner. I think that's him all right. I think that he's through, but the question is the time. Knight 3 here are going round paddock corner.
Knight
he's carrying
three.
Some speed there. Needs to swing it inside, just about catches it at the right moment. Round into the chicane. The question is the time. Is it good enough to beat Lajonie P Polytechnology? Remember, this is a diesel-powered car, and they are over the line. And let's just have a look to see what's good time. They've got a second. Oh, my goodness. 4 seconds.
Oh,
that is just 4 seconds behind. Lajonie P. I'll tell you what, I think the French were right there. I think not. We're a little worried about what that car could do, but they remain in pole position. Right, time to go to Ian back in the paddock.
Oh, this is wonderful. I'm with Eric here from Team Nipsa. From Birmingham. Look at him. Dressed great in the ultra gun. Look at him.
I'm very enjoying this day.
Three French teams now in the final. Fantastic.
Yes, it's very fantastic. The France is the best.
It's moving, guys. It's moving. We're going to get on the
news. Look at this. Allez, le bleu, my friend. Back to you.
Allez, le bleu.
It's
me trying to get a chart going remotely. That's quite difficult. Okay, Aya, thank you very much indeed. Nice little handshake there. What a colourful character he is. Let's see if he's going to be celebrating. I tell you what, if he's buying the drinks, I'm in your party, mate. 904 is the next car to go on track. That is ITS Team 2. This is the other of the Indonesian entries, along with Benguan. Remember, Benguan, they were second before. They slipped down to fourth. But that might suit them. They said they'd like to have a mid-pack qualifying grid position. That way they can just judge what's going on ahead of them, and they'll know what's going behind them, and they can go and judge the race from there. So maybe actually, That helped them, even though they were second, they're now fourth. ITS Team 2 are from the Institute of Technology, Sekula November. They were third in the Asia final. The green flag waved, and they are off and running. They were only seconds behind Benguan in the Asia final by 7 seconds. So they were third in total, but only 7 seconds separated them from Benguan in second. They've been involved in the Tokyo Marathon for 7 years. And nice, easy start to the lap for them. And there we see Thomas Academy experimental vehicle team. A little whisper in the panel that these guys might be the ones to watch. They won the America's final with the best lap of 1:47.4. They have a lot of changes in their car, including the steering wheel, the battery management support, the meter as well, and they are just ready to go. So we've got ITS Team 2 out on track, we've got St. Thomas Academy ready to go, and we've got Becky in the panic as well.
Now I found a friendly face. I like you here last year. Back again. How is it different from last year's edition?
This year we're waiting on our students and helping us out tremendously.
With you from the Nubo Goldbacks in the paddock. And not only that, here's something quite interesting. Chat lady just saw talking to Becky. He told me a story earlier on in the paddock. But logistically, they have real struggles for this race because he had his truck stolen. And then they're going to really use it to transport the cars. And it's actually, we've got one that's just sitting out on track here. Let's just come out here and just see what's happening. This is the top of the hill. And actually, you can see T904, ITS T2. How funny, they are stranded right at the top of the hill. Their battery is out at zero, and they are at the top of the hill. They simply didn't have enough to get over the brow of the hill.
Battery's out.
That's exactly what the dilemma is here, guys. It's about energy efficiency versus speed.
You've got another car.
Just slightly misjudged, and that tiny little error there means that they will not be able to complete their lap, and hopefully it's not a handbrake, otherwise you'll go rolling down. Back down that hill. So ITS Team 2 with Fejar Aditya, Billy Pozzetto, the 20-year-old in the cockpit, is stranded there, and that means that they've failed to log a qualifying time and may well be starting from the back of the grid. And we'll also check in on the St. Thomas Academy and their experimental vehicle, and we'll find out how they get on as they come towards the end of their lap. We're going to be just scanning across the screens to see roughly where they are as they've logged their qualifying time. Just to give you an update once more. Lajonifi Polytechnos with the leading time so far, 2 minutes 15.18 seconds. As you can see, the ITS Team 2 car being recovered. I tell you what, so far, this Drivers' World Championship Grand Final and the qualifying process for it is not going the way of the Asian teams. We lost the LSU Eco Car team in practice, they fell off there. Great test we're losing here, or at least they're getting back at the grid. An Indonesian team in the form of ITS Team 2, and they will be starting at the back of the grid. Team 905, St. Thomas Academy Experimental Vehicle Team. And now, they have got also a little history of drama in this particular competition. They rolled the car in the hairpin, back to electric car of last year. They produced a brand new car. And it looks very different, not just the livery, which is, special, shall we say, but also, in particular, that it's lighter, about 30 kilograms, lighter, 110 kilograms. It's lower, and it's wider than last year. And if you look very carefully, when we see the close-up of the shot of the car coming through, which you actually kind of can see here, as this car comes into the front of your shot, probably a bit difficult here, but basically, that car used to have two seats. It's now got one. and that means that the driver is more centrally placed within the car. Okay, going through the swimming pool complex, round one, and now into the aquatics curve. The left hand route to the right of the hairpin, Carpenter's hairpin, and coming out. So nice clean sweep there. They've got a good angle and a good exit, and it looks like the Westfield bend is not made too much of a problem to negotiate. So that's he's out of Westfield Bend and up towards the loop. So this is the Thomas Academy. The only concern here is the energy left. 30%, 28%, heading down towards 25%, and they're only through about half of the lap. Now they're heading through to the loop. This is the key bit. They're taking a tighter line, maybe to try and narrow down the distance, down to 20% on the battery. We know what happened to ITS Team 2. Have they learned from that experience? 14% left, down 12 now, and down into double figures, and into single figures now. This is the St. Thomas Academy experimental vehicle team. Can they get to the brow of the hill, down to 9%, down to 7%? I think they're gonna be okay. The mint green and orange livery vehicle is over the hill. I think they are Wits of Delight there from the American team from Minnesota, and they are down the other side of the hill. It really is the true test of this, and I think qualifying will provide many learnings for most of the teams in terms of how they use their energy over the course of this 1.6 kilometer lap. They're through the paddock corner, and through the paddock chicane, and I reckon this is going to be a middling time. I'm putting St. Thomas Academy here roughly in the middle of the pack. We'll see how they cross the line. They're over. Make a good pole! St. Thomas Academy experimental vehicle team, deceptive speed there, and they have taken pole by 0.7 of a second. St. Thomas Academy of America have made it an American pole by 0.8 of a second. Wow, what a performance there from Patrick Gaylor. Well, we said that there were whispers in the panel that these teams might be the ones to watch, the American teams. Well, it might well prove they've got two of the three teams, and the other one is Polytechnic in the top three. So St. Thomas Academy are on pole. La Jolie Polytechnic will be the second, and Knights 3 are third on the grid, and just 5 seconds separating those three teams. Then join Knights 3 in the second round, Nietzsche of France, and their car, which is one of the battery electric cars, the Burgundy car. And then you've got Benguan Team 2 from the Asian generation. They have come through, and they're the diesel car, and they have got the fifth place on the grid. That's usual for them. They said they wanted to be middle of the pack, and so it's proved. Yisen Chulong, second last year. They will start on the grid in sixth, then Newberg Goldbacks in seventh. ITS Team 2 will be eighth, even though they did not complete the lap. And obviously, as we mentioned before, we lost DLSU Eco Karting in practice. So it will be only an 8-team grid. So that is how it stacks up. St. Thomas Academy experimental vehicle team will be on pole. Patrick Gaynor, the 18-year-old from St. Paul in Minnesota, his first season with the team, he could well be propelling them into a very, very commanding position for the race itself. So that's what happens in qualifying so far, and we're going to have a look at what else we've got coming up, and we're building up to the race. Remember, we are live on Facebook from 4, and the race itself starts at 4:30 p.m. with St. Thomas Academy and La Jolie Polytechnic occupying the front row. Let's head back to Becky.
Well, it's suddenly got very busy in here. All the cars have now been pushed back into the paddock area, the halting area. They have all qualified at this time. They have got their position. It's very, very busy in here. But there looks to be a majority of happy faces, I have to say. But as they are just going to come here, they're going to regroup the drivers, they're going to get some water on board. It's very, very hot outside today. So in the meantime, let's take a look. Here is a video message from Team Ferrari.
Hi, I'm Sebastian Hetzel. 3,771 kilometers. That's how far some of you can travel on 1 liter of Shell. The energy efficient vehicles you produce year on year are quite simply amazing. Both Kimi and I are great admirers of the Shell Eco Marathon and the fantastic achievements you've made over the years. All of us at Scuderia Ferrari think this is going to be a fantastic event, which is why, together with Shell, we've put together a once-in-a-lifetime prize. all eight members of the winning team will travel the Scuderia Ferrari headquarters in Maranello, Italy, to enjoy the great Ferrari experience, as well as meet our colleagues and enjoy a factory
school. I want to wish everyone taking part in this year's Shelby Car Marathon the very best of luck.
So keep up the good work, and together we can help make the future.